talks we are having today is helping us to understand different levels of our life and how we can effectively lead others, and at the same time we are setting the direction.
Okay.
So thank you.
Cool. Anybody else think that Christian leadership development is important?
I think it's important. I'm thinking of a pastor.
Okay.
Right? With a vision. Yeah. And unless he has trained others to come along, or to come alongside the vision that he has, nothing will be implemented. Now, we have a situation where you mentioned that each and every one of us have been given a gift.
All more.
Yeah. As each one of you has received a gift, minister it to each other.
Mm.
That's the scripture. Now, unless the gifted are trained to managing what they have been gifted in, the pastor will remain as the only one who will be performing in the church whilst others are sitting back. So there's that aspect.
Can you get that? But don't you understand it takes a humble heart to tell you? Because a lot of time, once I've kind of been in church for 20 odd years and I've now made it to the pastor or I've made it to the head deacon, whatever structure you have, I'm there, God has got me here, the word of God. It's like I can't learn anything else. Forgetting that the world around us is changing, society is changing, we need to even be aware and learning about how they're doing it now. So even pastors talk about apps, computers, this and that. If in the church that that I've been to, it's like we don't want to have any of that. We just want the King James Version and that's it. No. That's how some people are, because that's where we've been given it and that's it. Not realizing that you keep reading the hours and these and that's and whatever, people will be like, what are you talking about? I'm out of it. Even the pastor says, well, let's just look in an early and an easy version. It's that kind of space, like that doesn't happen. Yes, it does. But that's what I'm talking about. We need to be willing to learn so that we can reach, we can develop ourselves. Anyway, so yes, it is important. So I'm glad you said that. Because I just want to leave you in a few minutes with a few new things. So here we go. So leadership development, should you bother, and whose responsibility is it? So we've got that Christian leadership is useful. We've got that Christian development is important. So should you bother, and whose responsibility is it?
I think because anyone who has people they are influencing, they are not automatically in leadership. So whoever is in that position is people that are following under me, then there is a need for them to recognize that they are leader, and therefore they have to have leadership. They have to be schooled in leadership. Then if it's under one or two people, so it could be in a department or at the higher level where you will have other leaders below. But as long as you are leading
somebody,
then you are having some social influence over there. So that's the responsibility for each one of those people.
That's amazing. Right. And that goes back to what you were saying. It's actually, well, if I've got something, I might need to learn to be able to give that to somebody else. So I might have amazing skills, but I might not know how to pass that on to somebody. I might need to go on a course or something to help me to do that.
Mm.
Yeah? Or I might think the only way to do it is my way, because it's like, well, not really. Because you're going to get somebody who's going to come into a church who does it differently.
Mm.
Okay? So cool. So here we go. The focus of leadership tends to be on three levels. Okay? So it tends to be on self. It tends to be on others. So we look at leading myself, we talk about leading other people. I'm talking about the context, which is the church or the business. I need to do things in order to make the business perform. Okay? So my question then is, where do you think leaders tend to focus most of their attention?
Self,
service, or context? terms
of self.
So how do we know? How do people say self?
They are all kind of, yeah.
Okay, so yourself as yourself. Okay, cool. Who says others?
Some others.
So is that a yes, others?
I would say a mixture.
And this we've got a couple of others. And who says business or the context?
Context.
And you don't say anything. So where do you think leaders put their attention?
It's a trigger one.
I think it could be in between others and content and they forget themselves.
Yes.
It can be that way. Yeah. Also, yeah. They can focus on themselves, forgetting what they should have
done. So here's the thing. When we go into businesses, as a leader, I go into businesses and I come to consult them. And the leader will tell me, yeah, all right, but what is coming? Can you do some work with my team? Can you do some work with my organization? And I never hear them say, would you do some work with me and my team? And I never come back and say, what have you taught them? What are they now going to do? And I never hear them say, what about you? So a lot of our time is spent looking at the organisation, looking at what we have to do for others. We don't put that eye on ourselves.
Yeah.
Which is why I'm asking the question, whose responsibility is it? Okay? So, and then the last bit that says, the majority of time we tend to focus on the other things. But the greatest leadership, just for your point, the greatest leadership impact actually occurs when the leader is able to bring all three areas together and be able to look at self, others, and the context at the same time. And we might need to learn how to do that too.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. So I'm saying then, before you can lead others effectively, leadership starts with yourself. To remember the word reminds us in the Colossians that whatever you do, do not live to the Lord. So when it comes to your leadership and your ongoing development, the question to ask yourself is this. Am I a do-as-I-say leader, or am I a do-as-I-do leader? Which one are you?
Say that again.
Are you a do-as-I-say leader, or are you a do-as-I-do leader?
Do-as-I-do.
It depends.
Okay, okay. I like honesty.
It depends.
Okay.
It
depends.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So here's the last question then before I show you a little thing. So how committed are you to understanding and becoming the leader that God has called you to be? How committed are you individually at understanding and becoming the leader that God has called you to be? You don't have to answer that one, but you want to think about that one. Okay. So as I come to our kind of end of our time together, I just want to briefly share a model that illustrates the importance of effective Christian leadership for you to ponder on. And to briefly share an exciting, I think, leadership opportunity to help enhance your leadership capability and to help you fulfill the kingdom impact of your church, if you're interested. And if I do whet your appetite, then we can arrange to talk more about the actual process itself and how you can take part. Okay, so if I'm interested, then make sure that I'll ask for your details later on. But first of all, this is what I call the gifted for action, which is the model, and leadership model. So I'm just going to work my way through this for you. Okay, so why is it when any organisation has governance, doesn't it? They have a board of executives, whatever, we have governance. So I'm saying, when we're in a godly organisation, we have spiritual governance. The word of God dictates what we do. Our relationship with God dictates what we do. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Cool. The Bible tells us that we're the salt of the earth. Okay, so we're supposed to lead by example. So in terms of the importance, godly and ethical leadership is really important. So if we're doing what God calls us to do and we're leading that example, our organisation should be better because God is with us than the best organisation in business. I say that again. If we are following God and we are being an example, our organisation should be better than the best business organisation.
I agree.
Because we've got God and they don't. So if it isn't, something ain't right.
Yeah.
I won't go there. Does that make sense? Okay. So I then go look at the Bible and I personal Lord, by the way. I went back and I looked at the Bible and I'm like, okay, so what is church all about really? So the what of church for me, and what it says is, we have these spiritual and leadership competencies together. So we've got spiritual and personal, I can't see what it says now, something. What was the word? Qualities, yes, it's qualities. We've got spiritual and personal qualities here. Qualities, yeah? And then this, and therefore, it's about managing people and processes. That's what we're in church to do. Managing people, processes, and resources. All the resources given to be able to manage it in order to make sure we're helping people to develop spiritually. Yeah? So that's our processes of worship, our resources, the tithes that we're supposed to be doing it for that mission. Yeah? Does that make sense? We also have to manage processes and tasks. So not only do we have to manage the people and the resources, we have to manage the tasks of worship, of spreading the gospel, of teaching. That's what we need to do in church. But actually, everything we're supposed to do according to Scripture is about meeting community needs. And that's internal to the community we have internally and also externally being a witness. Okay? So that, according to Scripture, is what church is about. And then I kind of go to myself, okay, so how, the how of church? So you go to every different church, and they're all done differently, aren't they? You feel different in different churches. So I'm like, why is that? So that's about, we have transformational and spiritual leadership. If we've got really God-ordained transformational leadership and people who are led by the Spirit, this is what happens. We're going to have people who are really good at engaging other people. So we're going to have our spiritual competencies in terms of our personal stuff. So that's me as a leader being spiritually minded and having a mind of God and doing that. Then it's going to be, well, how do I engage other people? So how do I work with you, sister? How do I work with you? How do I work with you individually? How do I develop you individually? And then I'm saying, well, actually, well, how do I engage the organisation? So if I've got different departments and different teams working, how do I engage with teams? How do I get teams to work together? As a leader, that's my responsibility, right?
Yeah.
And then I'm saying, actually, what about leading the church or the organisation forward? That's leadership. What's the vision? The Bible tells us about the vision of people perish, yeah? So if you keep the same vision yesterday and try to apply it 50 years later, it's not going to work. We need to change, yeah? So that's leading the church forward. And then we're talking about working within a wider organisation. So say you are a church and you've got one branch here, you've got another branch in Perivale. You're doing, the pastor needs to know what he's doing for this branch, because it might be different than Perivale, so he has to be able to do that as a leader. But you also need to work together to understand what the overall organisation wants. So you have to be able to work with the organisation as well as working with your local church. You have to be able to do that both things as a leader. Yeah? And if you do that, there's going to be some results. Because the Bible tells us there has to be some, right? Do you think we have to have results? Mm-hmm. Or not? We can just sit down. Do you think we need to have results?
Oh, yes.
Yeah? Well, you do. Does anybody else think we need to have results?
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, so here are some results. You're going to have people results. You're going to have every person in your congregation. Sorry. Purpose-driven lives, and you're going to make sure that you're working with individuals that they understand their purpose and God's purpose for their life is driving them. That's under your leadership. And if they're doing that, that means they're going to be doing active evangelism, because if I know what purpose is, I can't stop encouraging you if I'm an encourager. I can't stop teaching if that's what I'm supposed to do. Does that make sense? So all of a sudden, just because people are doing what you help them to do, active evangelism is happening in your church. Does that make sense? So you're starting to get ministries happening. And then finally, there are results, achieving goals. So you now get, because if everybody's working according to their giftings and they're actively involved in evangelism from their perspective, that helps you to understand what ministries you need to have. So if I'm, you know, looking after Paul, there's going to be an outreach. Do you understand what I'm saying? So people are going to tell you what they're department should be. And then you're going to get active ministries, and when everybody's doing what they're supposed to be doing, you're going to have community engagement internally and externally. just because we're doing it God's way. Does that make sense?
Amen.
So all I'm saying is, one of the things I looked at was that if we could find the behaviors that make that happen, and then we can help you to look at yourself as to whether you have those behaviors, would that be useful? I'm not going to go into it, but that's what the leadership development process is all about. And it's about revelation to revolution to results. So it's a way that you feel the impact that your current leadership style and approach has on your church and your community, to revolutionize your thinking so you get to think differently. You get to grow your leadership capacity and your capability, and you get to maximize results. Go back to what we said about leadership as a definition. Maximize your results by mobilizing people and creating a long-lasting legacy of social action and engagement in your local community. That can come by you understanding who you are as a leader and be willing to develop yourself. And that's basically the process that I'm working with, which I'm going to talk about another time. But it helps you to analyze and assess your leadership capability based on all of these areas. Practice, integrity, servanthood, caring for others, developing individual potential, embracing diversity, all of these things. And it helps you to understand who you are as a leader and helps you to put a plan in place to make you more effective. And it also means that you encourage people to talk and engage and share. And that's it. So, in conclusion, I hope that it helps you think a little bit deeper maybe what leadership is. And I hope you found it useful.
Yeah.
Something useful? Yeah? No? Useful?
Useful. Yes.
Okay, cool. That's good. And you've got something to take away. And so I've left a little grid on your sheet that just basically says give you to think about what you learned and you thought through. So spend some time at the end just thinking about how has that changed your concept of leadership now. And then the last thing is to say, just so that you know, I'm going to be looking for progressive thinking leaders to take part in an initial rollout of the Gifted for Action 360-degree kind of process. So if you're interested in taking part, please let me have your name or contact details, and I'll get in touch with you with more information as it rolls out. But this is about willingness to kind of go, who am I? Where do I need to develop? What is God calling me to do? Where do I fall short, or where am I good? And what do I need to do to be even better? That's what's on offer, as long as there's other things as well. And it's part of a big program about actually checking out your giftedness for action. Anyway, that's all that's left to say is to say thank you for your cooperation.
Welcome.